All right, so in this video, I want to cover the five major perspectives in psychology. And what that refers to is five different approaches to studying human thought and behavior. So as you may have already read in the textbook, the definition of psychology, let me go back to it right here, is right here, the scientific study of thought and behavior. So this semester, we're studying why humans think and behave the way we do. But to do that, there are different levels of analysis that we need to take. And those are listed right here for you. These five perspectives offer different levels of analysis to answer that question, why do humans think and behave the way we do? So this is essentially the overarching goal of this class. I want you to understand human thought and behavior from each of these five perspectives. So let's look at each one briefly, individually. So the first is the biological perspective, and there's an entire chapter on biology. We're going to come up to that soon. But right now, just think of the biological perspective as the hardware. In other words, what is the brain doing? What is the body doing? The actual physiological mechanisms involved in thought and behavior. So for example, when I enact any behavior, that involves certain biological functions. And so from one perspective, we can explain human thought and behavior from a biological perspective. For example, let's take a mental disorder as an example. So let's look at major depression, major depressive disorder. From a biological perspective, you could argue that depression occurs as a result of a, quote, a chemical imbalance. And that is a very different level of analysis than these other four. Now, these are not competing. They're not against each other. They're simply adding to our explanation of human thought and behavior. So let's look at the second perspective. The second perspective, known as behaviorism, is all about the environment. It's all about how we react to environmental influences. So for example, again, let's look at depression. A person might get depressed if they are fired from their job or if they experience the death of a loved one. So that might explain that thought and behavior, depression, but from a different perspective than the biological perspective. Remember, the biological perspective was all about physiological mechanisms, what's happening in the body and the brain, whereas behaviorism takes a different level of analysis. It focuses on the environment. Again, they're not against each other. They're simply adding additional information to the explanation of human thought and behavior. This is an extremely complex idea, and so we take different levels of analysis, different approaches to that question. The third perspective is known as the psychodynamic perspective, and this was developed by Sigmund Freud, a name that you'll probably hear a lot this semester. And what the psychodynamic perspective argues is that we have a conscious and subconscious aspect to our mind. So for example, when it comes to the conscious, there are things that I am aware of. I know why I do certain things. But from a subconscious perspective, this argues that I'm guided by thoughts that I'm not even aware of myself. And these stem from early childhood experiences. So for example, somebody might experience major depressive disorder because they are holding on to repressed memories of abuse or trauma from their childhood. But these are not things that they're thinking about every single day at a conscious level. They're somehow influencing the individual in a subtle, subconscious way. So again, it's a different level of analysis. I know this is a little bit vague right now, but we are definitely going to cover these perspectives in much greater detail across the semester. Right now, it's just a broad introduction. So next, the humanistic perspective. The humanistic perspective is all about growth and potential. The idea that all of us are here to find our true selves. So humanistic psychology, it has a specific term known as self-actualization. The idea is that all of us are trying to grow and better ourselves and to reach this thing called self-actualization, which means reaching your full potential, becoming the person that you were meant to be. This is a very philosophical approach, and one thing that is interesting to note, which again you probably read in the textbook in the history of psychology, is that psychology is new. Psychology is, you know, about 150 years old, but it has its roots in two other major scientific fields, and that is biology and philosophy. So the humanistic perspective is very much a philosophical approach to understanding human thought and behavior. It understands that, it tries to emphasize that all of our thoughts and behaviors are geared towards bettering ourselves, towards reaching our full potential. And that's probably different for every single person. So what helps you reach self-actualization is probably different than other students in the class. Finally, the cognitive perspective. The cognitive perspective is all about mental processes. It's all about how the mind processes information, kind of like a computer. So for example, there's an input and an output, but between those two steps, the mind is processing information. So again, going back to our example of major depressive disorder, somebody might experience depression from a cognitive perspective because they're thinking about things in a pessimistic way. So for example, somebody gets fired from a job, somebody with depression, they might process that experience very differently than somebody who's not depressed. Somebody with depression might say, I'm worthless, I don't deserve to live. Whereas somebody who's not depressed might take that same experience and say, you know, I deserve better. So the cognitive perspective focuses on mental processes. So again, let's review each one, and I'll kind of highlight the important aspects of each. So think of the biological as the physiological aspects of the brain and genetics and the endocrine system and everything going on with the actual body. Think of behaviorism as environmental influence. Think of psychodynamic as the relationship between our conscious and subconscious mind. Think of the humanistic perspective as focusing on growth and potential, and the cognitive perspective as focusing on mental processes. All right, so those are the five major perspectives in psychology. You're going to hear, again, a lot about each one of these this semester. By the end of the semester, you will be well-versed in each one of these. Let's just touch upon a few other elements of psychology as a whole. Down here you see the theory of evolution. Of course, Darwin's theory of evolution plays a role in psychology because it basically argues that human thought and behavior is not an accident, that everything we do, it must have helped our ancestors survive in some way. And so from an evolutionary perspective, you can explain human thought and behavior through survival of the fittest and natural selection. That's certainly an interesting and important element of human thought and behavior. So we'll touch upon evolution this semester. The textbook goes into detail on the biopsychosocial model, and you've probably heard about the idea of nature versus nurture. You know, why does somebody do something? Why does somebody become an alcoholic? Why does somebody become depressed? Is it nature? Is it nurture? Well, the biopsychosocial model basically expands upon the nature-nurture argument, and it basically argues that human thought and behavior, I'm going to keep going back to this slide, human thought and behavior is the product of biological forces, you know, genes, the brain, social forces, so the environment, the people, the places that we are surrounded by, and psychological factors, in other words, the mind and our personality. So human thought and behavior is the product of an interaction between biological, psychological, and social forces. That makes us unique because each one of us has a different combination of these three factors. Over here you see some subfields in psychology. One of the things that you'll learn this semester is that psychology is an extremely broad field. When you hear that somebody is a psychologist, that means that could mean many different things. And I think what is common is to assume that psychology just means therapy. Personally, I think many people probably have the notion in mind that when you think of psychology, you think of somebody laying down on a couch and talking about their problems to a counselor. And that is an important part of therapy. You know, clinical or counseling psychology is a really important part of this field. But it's actually only a small part. A much larger part is research. And research psychologists fall under many different categories. So personally, I am a developmental psychologist. And what that means is that I study how human thought and behavior changes over time. And what I've looked at in my research is aggressive behavior. How does aggression change from childhood to adulthood? But as you'll see, there are many different subfields in psychology. So what I would argue is that there's something for everybody in psychology. And this semester, you'll probably find that there are certain topics that you really find interesting. There might be other topics that you don't find all that interesting, and that's okay. But it is a very diverse field. Psychology is a very large field, and I think that you will learn that as we go. All right, so that's all for this video. Again, we're covering the five major perspectives, and this is not something you need to have memorized by any means at this point. This is just to let you know that human thought and behavior, it's a complex idea. And so we have to approach this from different perspectives to get a fully comprehensive understanding of human thought and behavior. All right, I'll see you in the next video.